Good morning. First Target has three prior removals from the United States.
It's 5 a.m. in Los Angeles, and these ICE agents have a list of names they're after.
He has DUI convictions.
Individuals they say crossed the border illegally and have been charged with crimes on American soil. That's David Marin, field office director for ICE in L.A. ICE asked that we conceal other agents' faces. These agents have been surveilling the men for weeks. They know the car they drive, what time they drop their kids off at school.
Radio check.
And what route they take to work.
Copy.
There's a truck right behind you with its lights on. I'm gonna swing right behind that truck.
Sounds good to me.
All right. December 24th, he was arrested for a violation of a court order. So we placed a detainer. For some reason, they didn't turn him over to us. If they would have turned us over to him right then and there and in the jail, wouldn't have to use these resources.
Have we got eyes on the subject?
This is a criminal alien. He's been deported, you know what, twice before.
Entregar tu propiedad a tu mamá, okay?
Okay.
All right, so he says this guy comes out anytime after 7:50, so he should be coming out soon.
Today, they're able to arrest three out of the five undocumented people without incident.
How would you define a successful day doing apprehensions?
So exactly what you've seen so far, us getting a criminal alien off the street and out of the community.
But for ICE, this isn't ideal. They say their hands are tied by sanctuary city policies, policies ICE calls a threat to public safety. American sanctuary cities emerged in the 70s and 80s. Today, 39 communities in four states bill themselves as safe havens for undocumented immigrants. Generally speaking, these jurisdictions limit cooperation with federal immigration agents by not honoring detainment requests and denying ICE access to jails and prisons.
Sanctuary policies are protecting criminal aliens. They prevent law enforcement from working with ICE. Again, we don't ask them to do our job. What we ask them just to do is notify us when somebody that we want is in their custody.
Obama! Escucha!
Even the Obama administration criticized sanctuary cities, angering his base. So why does it seem like we're hearing so much about them now?
They're bringing drugs. They're bringing crime. They're rapists.
Well, it goes back to 2015 and the start of Donald Trump's presidential campaign.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Trump and his supporters have pointed to violent crimes and killings in sanctuary cities as justification for tighter immigration restrictions. Several of the administration's attempts to defund sanctuary cities have been blocked. Earlier this year, a federal appeals court did grant the administration authority to award preferential treatment for certain policing grants when cities cooperate with immigration authorities.
What he seeks to do is paint all of us with this image of criminality. And so it's very easy to use the most egregious case, rape and murder. But in those are such few instances. And yet they're used in order to allow for all of these other millions of human beings to be deported.
Angelica Salas is the executive director of the Coalition for Humane Immigrant Rights Los Angeles, or CHIRLA. Her organization claims sanctuary city policies keep immigrant communities safe.
In places like Los Angeles County and City, what has happened is all they've done is set a higher bar in making determinations as to who is going to be turned over to ICE. And I think it's a good thing because I think it safeguards our community, it safeguards families, and it also creates a situation in which people, independent of your immigration status, trust the police to fight crime.
Would you like to see ICE abolished?
This is an agency that's rogue. And I think that Americans need to understand their tax dollars are paying for violations of human rights. I don't think that we have to be so close-minded to this idea that maybe if we look a little deeper, this is a system, a law enforcement system that has to be reformulated. And that's very different from saying that we don't need to secure our borders.
The Trump administration sued the state of California for obstructing federal immigration enforcement. They lost. A federal court upheld the California Values Act, ruling, quote, standing aside does not equate to standing in the way.
Deportation is the consequence that comes with entering into the country illegally. Do you think that it should be decriminalized?
I think our immigration laws are set up so that people of color do not have access to legal migration in this country.
Even though Trump's deportation numbers have ticked up since the last year of Obama's tenure, they come nowhere close to the more than 400,000 deportations during the peak year of Obama's presidency in fiscal year 2012. Even the proportion of people deported via interior removals, not at the border, has ticked back down. And that's what's happening here back at the ICE staging facility in downtown LA. Today's detainees are being processed. Some will have their day in immigration court and learn whether they'll face deportation.
Immigration rights groups would say that sanctuary city policies help protect families and keep families intact. They don't want to see people who are in the country illegally, who maybe have not committed a crime, get swept up into these enforcement actions that you're doing. Is there any truth to that? Do sanctuary city policies help keep families intact?
I think what they're really doing is they're forcing us to be out in the community more. So without these sanctuary city policies, if we could work inside of the jails and be in the jails, that's where we would be encountering people. But because of sanctuary policies, we can't be in the jails, so we're out on the streets. And that's where we're going to be encountering people that are non-criminal, but in this country illegally.
Nery Escobar Celis has been deported to Guatemala three times. He got a DUI 7 years ago, and last year he was arrested on domestic violence charges. His two young children were inside as he was arrested.
Why did I come here from Guatemala? Because there's a lot of insecurity. There's no work. My whole family is here. I don't have anyone in Guatemala. That's why I'm here. I think I'm going to do the same thing again. I can't be over there. I don't have anyone. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I need to be here with my kids.
A couple of weeks after we spoke, Nery was removed to Guatemala again.
One man that I spoke to told me that if he's deported to Guatemala, he will come back over the U.S. border. He will try again. I mean, what's your reaction to that? What does that make you think about how this whole system works?
I mean, it's unfortunate. That individual has already been removed twice to Guatemala, and now he's telling us that, go ahead and remove me, but I'm going to come back. You know what? That speaks to the need for immigration reform.
The need for reform is actually something both sides agree on. It's the debate over solutions that continues to divide.
Hey, NBC News viewers, thanks for checking out our YouTube channel. Subscribe by clicking on that button down here and click on any of the videos over here to watch the latest interviews, show highlights, and digital exclusives. Thanks for watching.